Well, welcome to this service here at Newtown Baptist Church, this virtual service today in these strange days in which we live. Thank you for joining us, members of the regular congregation here, and any others who've joined us today. We read these words in Psalm 100. It's a psalm for giving thanks. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generation. And we're praying that God will help us to worship him today. Even though we can't gather together, we pray that in the same way as we often pray, that he'll meet, especially with those who are sick and not able to gather with us, that he will meet with us in our homes. We're going to listen to a song together now before we pray and read God's word.
Is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, in pride or shame.
Trust in him now.
So our Bible readings today are firstly from Matthew chapter 5 and then from Romans 12 and 13. So please turn with me in your Bible to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 38. And we're going to read these words of Jesus from the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5, verse 38. You have heard that it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemies. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And then turn with me to Romans chapter 12. We're continuing our series in the book of Romans. And we'll read from verse 9. We looked at verses 9 to 13 last week. We're going to look at verses 14 to 21 this week. But we'll pick it up at Romans 12, verse 9, and read through to chapter 13 and verse 10. Romans 12, verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath, to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants, who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honour. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command: love your neighbour as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbour, therefore love is the fulfilment of the law. Well, please turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 12. In the passage that we're considering today, we see how God's people are to respond to persecution. And I want to tell you immediately why this is relevant to us now, whether we're a Christian or not. If we're a Christian, we're reminded that there are Christians in other parts of the world who are being persecuted, some very severely, for their faith in Christ. Coronavirus may be a problem to them, but it's not the main one. In fact, it may be only a minor problem compared to others. We think of Christians in North Korea, in China, in Russia, in North Africa, more and more in West Africa, down that strip in East Africa, Somalia, Kenya, and so on. Christians all across the Middle East, in India, who are being persecuted for their faith. They are being beaten up and tortured today. There are Christian women who don't know when their husbands are going to be released from prison, whether they ever will be. They don't know where their children are. Their children have been abducted and they don't know where they are. Or they're just mourning because their husbands have been killed, their children have been killed. They're feeling deep pain and loss, and we need to remember them at this time. We can be, can't we, extremely self-absorbed at this time. And these verses remind us that some Christians are severely persecuted for their faith, or seriously persecuted anyway. So we need to pray intelligently and earnestly for them today. Secondly, some of us who are watching, some of you who are watching, may actually get a hard time at work, certainly when work is normal, or at home because you're a Christian. You may be criticised or ridiculed or cold-shouldered. You're viewed as old-fashioned, as foolish. You're deluded to pray to an invisible being. You're living in denial of reality. You're weird. You are peculiar. You're considered naive and prudish because you're honest and you're pure. You're antisocial because there are things that you will not join in with. You are awkward and difficult. Perhaps at this time, you're not prepared to exploit and abuse the government's emergency measures, but you know you have to be completely truthful. You're not going to massage the figures. You will only claim what is absolutely legitimate. Perhaps you can't watch what everybody else is watching in your house, and others resent that. So you're the butt of jokes, you're ridiculed, you're scorned, you're ignored, and sometimes this stings. And sometimes you feel additionally isolated. And I just want to say, the Bible says anyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So if you're a Christian, you need to take note of this teaching. You may not feel you're being persecuted now, but you will be. If you want to live a godly life, if you do live a godly life, you will be persecuted for following the Lord Jesus Christ. And then all of us, for whatever reason, are sometimes unfairly, unkindly treated. That is life. I remember a primary school teacher used to tell us regularly, life is not fair, life is unfair. He felt that was a lesson we needed to learn. And right now, the impact of coronavirus places strains on relationships. Some think other people are overreacting, they're neurotically fearful. Something others are careless and irresponsible. Some people feel lonely and neglected. Others are cooped up like chickens, and there's a lot of tension in their household. And we're not even a couple of weeks into social distancing. We have weeks, probably months, to go. We're under pressure. And those we work with, either physically or remotely, if we are working, or those we live with, they can treat us unkindly. Or as I said, we might just feel unfairly neglected. And I want to say, if you're not a Christian, I'm really glad you're watching today. But these verses require not only a pattern of behaviour, but a way of thinking that is utterly impossible to keep without Jesus, without God working in your life. You may not even be sure you want to live like this. It shows you that great need for regeneration, to be born again, as Jesus said in John chapter 3. That need for the powerful work of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ in your life. If some parts of Romans are doctrinal and hard to understand, this part is just hard to practice. It takes something supernatural to live out these commands. So we're in this great second section of Paul's letter to the Romans. Chapter 12, verse 1 is the turning point. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. We like that song that we've learned recently. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. And the mercy of God is the great motivation for Christians. That mercy that Paul's spoken of in chapters 1 to 11. That mercy that was demonstrated in the great atoning sacrifice of Christ upon the cross and in his mighty resurrection from the dead. That mercy which showers blessing upon blessing upon us. It's a motor, it's a driver for us. So Paul, in this chapter, he urges Christians in verses 3 to 8 to humbly use the gifts God has given them to serve one another. And then there are a series of appeals in verses 9 to 13. They kind of pad out what genuine love is. And now Paul turns to the subject of persecution. The Christians in Rome were evidently being persecuted. Verse 14, bless those who persecute you. And you may know that there was a time when the Christians in Rome were ferociously persecuted. They were thrown to the lions. They were burned alive. And that time is, in fact, not too far ahead of when Paul wrote this letter. But I think it's evident from chapter 13 that at this stage it's not like that. They are being persecuted. At least some of these Christians in Rome are being persecuted. Paul speaks of them suffering in chapter 5. He speaks of suffering and groaning in chapter 8. He writes Romans 8, verses 35 to 37. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. And then he goes on, no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Now, Paul certainly knew this level of persecution, and so did some of his companions. But at this stage, I think we can infer that the persecution in Rome was uneven. Some of the Roman Christians were suffering, but it's clear from chapter 13 that the state was not persecuting Christians. So what you experienced might depend on such things as your status in society, the trade you worked at, the master you worked for if you were a slave, the husband you were married to if you were a Christian woman. Some Christians may have been beaten up and harshly treated. Others may have just been viewed as awkward or unpatriotic because they didn't worship the Roman gods. And others were probably still respected. So my impression, at least, is that the persecution is uneven and nowhere yet at the level it would soon escalate to. So we have this headline, if you like, in verse 14. And then in verses 15 and 16, Paul tells Christians how they are to act towards one another as they suffer persecution. And then in verses 17 to 21, how they are to act towards their persecutors. So this kind of introductory headline, I'm calling it, in verse 14, it's very straightforward, isn't it? Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse. It is natural to want to curse those who persecute us or treat us unfairly. We feel angry, we feel ill will, we want to call them names, we want to say derogatory things about them. We want them to suffer because of what they've done to us. But Paul calls us to bless them. We are to pray for them. We're to pray God will do them good, that they will know his love, his mercy, that they will not suffer what they deserve, that their hearts might be softened. We're to pray that we might be reconciled to them in Christ and be able to spend eternity with them. And if you are familiar with Jesus' teaching, you know Paul is echoing Jesus here. That's why we read from the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 earlier. Jesus told his disciples they were not to retaliate, and they were to turn the other cheek. They were to go the second mile. Listen again to what he says. You've heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. That was startling. It was extremely challenging. It went way beyond the ethics of pagans or of Jews. And remember, wonderfully, as again, Jesus practiced what he preached. He didn't retaliate when he was mocked, when he was roughed up, when he was tortured. And you know how on the cross he prayed, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. When Stephen, the first martyr, died, he followed Jesus' example. This is what we read in Acts 7. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he said this, he fell asleep. And remember, Paul, the author of this letter, before he was converted, he witnessed that. In fact, he approved of Stephen's death, but he witnessed Stephen actually praying for those who were killing him. I think bless probably extends to practical things here. We're to do them a good turn. We're to work hard for them. We're to put ourselves out for them. We're to help them, but more of that later. So that's the headline here. And then secondly, Paul turns to how Christians should treat their fellow Christians as they're being persecuted. And I say treat, but actually it goes way beyond actions to our thoughts, the whole way we think, our mindset. So the reason that I think Paul has Christians in mind in these two verses is because we have one another here again, live in harmony with one another. We had that in verse 10, be devoted to one another in love, honor one another above yourselves. And also what Paul says here, verse 15, seems to echo what he wrote to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He speaks there of Christians being parts of one body, just as he does earlier in this chapter. And he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 26, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honoured, every part rejoices with it. So can you see how he's echoing that here? So it seems some Christians are suffering, but for others, life's okay. It's good even. And so he says, rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. You know, there is, isn't there, this really nasty, lamentable human instinct to resent other people's joys and to take pleasure in their misfortunes. But in Christ, we are to be the reverse. We are to give thanks to God. You know, perhaps we're single and we want to get married, and one of our friends gets married, well, we are to rejoice with them. Or, you know, one of our friends gets good results or they get a promotion, we're to rejoice with them. You know, if another church is being particularly blessed by God, we are to rejoice with that church. So we celebrate with them. But on the other hand, when they're suffering, we're not to be careless, we're not to be indifferent, we are to mourn with them. If someone loses a child or they're made redundant or they suffer some other kind of calamity, you know, we can't just go out and party when they are grieving. We sympathize for them. We weep for them. We weep with them. And Paul says in verse 16, live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. And, you know, persecution can bring tensions. Somebody else is doing okay, somebody else isn't. And, you know, somebody's wondering when they're going to be beaten up again and so on. Someone else may feel that Christian's been unwise and they've brought persecution upon themselves. The persecuted may feel the lies of others are easy, you know, they're inauthentic. But Paul says, you know, live in harmony with one another. Don't be proud. Don't be conceited. Associate with people of low position. You know, that person, they're in old clothes and they're a bit worn out and perhaps they're driving a battered car. They're kind of the down and outs. Well, don't be ashamed to associate with them. Or this phrase could be translated, engage in lowly things. So we might think here of Christ washing the disciples' feet, you know, doing the work of a slave. Be prepared to do the humble, the behind the scenes, the overlooked jobs. I want you to think of the carers who toil at the sick and the frail, who dress them, who undress them, who get their meals ready for them, who do the washing up, who rub cream onto their legs and their feet and so on. Or think of the doctors and the nurses who we're very thankful are working on the front line at the moment. So we need to be prepared to do lowly things and even risky things sometimes. So that might mean, you know, standing in a queue for 45 minutes outside Sainsbury's, not in the sunshine but in the rain, to pick up supplies for somebody. Or think about this, if somebody falls sick and they have no family to look after them and the hospitals are at capacity, who's going to do that? And that's something Christians are called to do. So that's how Christians are to act towards one another when they, some of them anyway, are suffering persecution. Thirdly, Paul talks about how Christians should act towards their persecutors. And again, it's not just act, but it's how they're to think. So he writes here, verse 17, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Paul, by the way, he doesn't deny, does he, that there is evil. He doesn't deny, as some religions and some cults do, that there is real evil, that there is real wickedness, suffering, that it has long-term effects. But he says, don't repay evil for evil. Don't engage in some tit-for-tat vendetta. Don't, you know, blank somebody. Don't try and get even with them. But he says, be careful to do what's right in the eyes of everyone. You know, this just reminds us, people who are not Christians, they do have a sense of right and wrong. Some things are widely understood to be right or wrong, and well, we're to do what's right in the eyes of everyone. And then Paul goes on, he says, if it's possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. So, you know, there is this danger, certainly, of Christians not speaking up when they ought to, something I'm very conscious of, I'm sure many of you are too. But there is also a danger of Christians being, you know, combative, abrasive, you know, rebuking people for what they're doing this and they're doing that. And in general, the New Testament teaches that our lives are to adorn the gospel. They're to make the gospel beautiful. They are to be the rebuke to people for the way that they're living. And if those around us, they don't want to hear about Jesus, they don't want to hear about the gospel, then we are to win them with our words. But note that Paul qualifies what he says here. He says, as far as it depends on you. Because sometimes, you know, it doesn't depend on you. It's not in your power or my power to achieve peace. We might be kind of living with somebody or working with somebody. They're just very angry. They're just hostile. They're very spiteful. You know, whatever we do, we can't live in peace with them. Or they may ask us to do something that we just can't do. They may ask us to lie on the phone for them, and we just say, well, we can't do that for you. So it's not peace at any cost, but we seek peace. We try and live at peace with everyone. And then in verse 19, Paul says, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. So Paul is saying, you know, you can leave it to God to deal with this justly. You know, God knows what somebody's done, and he will see that justice is done. And there are different ways in which that is worked out by God. It can be worked out. He's sovereign over all things. It can be worked out in the lives of people, in events, in life now. Or, you know, we read in chapter 13 how the government is established by God. It's there to kind of encourage what's right and to deter what's wrong. And Paul says, chapter 13, towards the end of verse 4, that the authorities are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. So through the authorities, God may see to it that somebody is punished. Or of course, thirdly, on the day of judgment, you know, everybody's going to have to give an account of their life to God, and God will see that justice is done. So Paul is saying, rest assured, you know, you don't have to worry about this. God will see that justice is done. You don't need to take it into your own hands. You don't need to be the local vigilante. Leave it with God. You know, we read of Jesus in 1 Peter 2. When they hurled insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Here it comes. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. And Paul, then he goes on the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. And this seems to me, in context, to be something positive. He's told us to bless those who persecute us. He goes on to say, overcome evil with good. He talks about doing good to your enemies, buying them a meal, buying them a drink, feeding them, and so on. And this reference to burning coals, something what Paul is saying is that this will bring shame on the person. You know, they will be burning with shame when you repay their unkindness with kindness. I read once an old writer observed how in siege warfare, the inhabitants of a besieged city might rain burning coals on their enemies to repel them. And it's possible, Paul is saying then, by doing this, you will repel your enemies. You will defeat your enemies by showing them kindness in this kind of way. But he rounds it all off, verse 21. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. If they do evil to you and you do evil to them, or if you nurse evil desires in your heart, you have been defeated. If you've become embittered, you have lost the battle. But if you do
if they do evil to you and you do them good, and not only that, but you mean their good, you seek their good, you pray for their salvation, you know, you have won. You've overcome evil there. I can think of many heroic examples of Christians loving their enemies, praying for their persecutors. You know, there was a Christian archbishop of Uganda, Jenani Luan. He was murdered under the regime of Idi Amin in 1977. The state was persecuting Christians there. But before he was killed, he prayed for the prisoners who were imprisoned with him. He refused to sign a fake confession. He prayed for the men who took him away and stripped him and whipped him and worse before they killed him and then sort of mutilated his body. Or I remember last year, I was grateful for the opportunity to go to Sri Lanka, and it was almost the first day I was there. I went to a wedding in a church, a Christian church, the only Christian church in this Hindu village. And the pastor of that church, he'd been a Hindu, he'd put his trust in Christ, he was pastoring this church, and about a year or so before, I think it was, some young men, some youths from the village, very angry at what he was doing, he was preaching the gospel, they came and they beat him up with iron bars. They beat him up pretty badly. And he did actually report this to the police. And the police came and they detained these young men. But this pastor, he decided he wouldn't press charges against them. And, you know, I was attending this wedding, and of course a lot that was going on I didn't understand. But afterwards I was told, and it was very encouraging for the Christians there, these young men were among those who came to the wedding. They actually came along to that church, and they heard the gospel preached there. So that's an example, isn't it, in a way, of somebody overcoming evil with good. And for us, it probably means, you know, in little ways, being patient, being, you know, tolerant, showing kindness to people who are unkind to us. So, this passage is important. It reminds us to pray for Christians who are being persecuted. Our brothers and sisters across the world, we need to keep praying for them. It teaches us how to respond if we're having a hard time because we're a Christian, or just we're just being treated unfairly and unkindly by other people. And then I just want to say again in conclusion, if you are not a Christian, then you can't do this. You cannot do this without God. You know, there are people who you could hardly consider your enemies, who you find it hard to get along with. How will you ever live like this except by the transforming power of the Holy Spirit? So you need to pray. You need to ask for God's forgiveness through Christ. You need to ask him to change you so that you can do by the power of God what you cannot do yourself. Let's pray together now. Father, we thank you for your word. It's good, it's right, it's noble, it's beautiful. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, and that we have a Saviour who's given us a perfect example to follow. Father, we absolutely need your Holy Spirit to help us to do what your word commands us to do here. Forgive us all bitterness, all impatience, all unkindness. Help us, we pray. Help us in these strange days. Bless our fellowship in Christ, and may our love for you and our love for one another grow warmer rather than cooler at this time, and may others seek your face. We do pray for our brothers and sisters across the world, living in poverty, being persecuted, who are in prison, harassed, threatened. Give them much grace. Help them to love their enemies and pray for their persecutors. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. And we're going to close now with a closing song. See you next week.
Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.